the four galuyot. There's many proofs before they happened that they were going to happen. Some bring proofs even from the beginning of the Torah, and page one of the Torah, where the Torah says, "Ve'aretz hayta tohu vavohu, v'choshech al penei tehom." That all these already are remes to the galut. Tohu is one galut, vohu is another galut, choshech is another galut, tehom is the fourth galut. In the first pasuk is telling you, "Ve'aretz hayta tohu vavohu, v'choshech al penei tehom." Boom, remes to the four exiles. That means it's so basic in our existence that already on page one of the Torah tells us there's going to be galuyot. Of course, the galut Babel was the first one. Galut Babel only lasted 70 years. It wasn't a long galut. But after all, they did destroy the first Beit HaMikdash. The second galut was the galut of Paras u'Madai. That's the story of Purim, Haman. Then they built the second Beit HaMikdash. The Beit HaMikdash was completed. Then we had the Greeks. The Greeks disturbed the operations of the Beit HaMikdash temporarily until the Hashmonaim came back and restored it. And then we had the Romans, the Romaim, Titos, and they are the ones that are responsible for destroying the second Beit HaMikdash. That's the longest of the four galuyot, Galut Romi. Galut Romi is now over 1900 years, more, 1940 something years. The way you calculate Galut Romi is very simple. Kambaruch used to tell us, Hayim Miyeshu. Hayim Miyeshu. Which means you take the date of Yeshu, which is 2015. The English date, which we call the English date, is from Yeshu's death. And you take Hayim from Yeshu. Hayim is 68. So 2015 minus 68, that's how you know how many years ago the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed. So do the math. Elliot, 2015 minus 68.
1947.
So that's how many years ago the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed. That's it. Hayim Yeshu. So you see over here, where Galut Babel was only 70 years, Galut Romi is 1947 years. So it's more than 20 times. It's longer than all the Galuyot combined. The four galuyot are merumaz by the Ramban. The Ramban says when Avraham Abinu threw himself into a war, so there was a war of the four kings against the five kings. So he says that the four kings represent the four exiles, and Avraham Abinu, when he went into this war to fight against the four kings, that's a remez that Bnei Yisrael are going to be at battle in the four exiles. There's many, many allusions to this throughout the Torah. The Achamim give a remez. They ask a question. Haida asks the question. He says, "What do you mean four galuyot? Why don't you count Egypt as part of the one of the galuyot? What happened to Mitzrayim? Mitzrayim is the first exile." So the Haida says Mitzrayim is the mother exile. That means Mitzrayim is not counted. Mitzrayim had elements of all the exiles in it, and therefore all the exiles are a result of Mitzrayim. So you don't count Mitzrayim. And Mitzrayim almost gave birth to the other exiles. If you remember when Moshe Rabbeinu was at the burning bush, and God told him, you know, tell the people, Ehyeh Asher Ehyeh. Moshe Rabbeinu says, "What's the name? I need a name. They're going to ask me what your name is." So he says, "Tell them, I will be what I will be." So the Mefarshim, I will be what I will be. Yeah, So the Mefarshim say that tell them that I, just like I will be with them in this exile, I'll be with them in the other exiles as well. So Moshe Rabbeinu said, hey, Dayal Tzara B'Sha'ata, I don't want to depress them that there's going to be more exiles. But already it was understood from the beginning there's going to be more exiles. So Egypt already is the mother exile. So the Chidah says, Ve'ele Shemot B'nei Yisrael, these are the names of B'nei Yisrael, Habaim Mitzrayma, that came down to Egypt. So if you take the word Ba'im, Ba'im is a Shetevot, Babel, Edom, which is Rome, Yavan, and Madai, which is Parasu Madai. Habaim Mitzrayma. That all of the Habaim, all of the exiles, already in Mitzrayim. Habaim Mitzrayim. And we gave a remez to this, that every day we say the Amidah, Umevi Goel Ibne Bnehem Lema'an Shemo Be'ahava. Umevi Goel, God's going to bring the Redeemer. Mevi is Rashi Tevot, Madai, Bavel, Yavan, Edom. He's going to bring the Redeemer in order to redeem us from Mevi, from the Galut. Now, Chida also said a remez in last week's Parashat, Parashat Mas'e. In Parashat Mas'e, it talks about the traveling that the Jewish people took in the Midbar. So the Pasuk says, Ele Mas'e B'nei Yisrael. These are the travelings of B'nei Yisrael. You want to know the travelings? Ele is Aleph. Aleph is what? Edom. Mas'e Madai. B'nei Babel, Yisrael, Yavan. Ele Mas'e B'nei Yisrael. These are going to be our travelings. Our travelings are going to be from one galut to another galut to another galut to another galut. Four galuyot. This was also Merumaz in the famous dream that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream one night. And he didn't understand what the dream was. Most of the time, the dreams are just a figment of his imagination, subconscious thoughts that he had during the day. But once in a while, a dream can have like a level of prophecy in it, a level of revelation in it. The dreams of Par'o, for example. Par'o's dreams had futuristic messages. And Yosef would... Huh?
Yosef.
What about Yosef?
The dreams of Yosef.
The dreams of Yosef, absolutely. They also had futuristic understanding too. Very good. Now also applies to daydreaming as well. Now the subject over here, so Nebuchadnezzar knew that this wasn't a regular dream. This was not a stamp dream. Hazak Baruch. Mavgim lo kosheni. That's one of the bad habits I picked up in the yeshiva. I got addicted to coffee. Like a doctor. You cannot wake up early in the morning and go to sleep late at night without getting addicted to some type of caffeine beverage.
At least it wasn't cigarettes,
correct.
No,
I'll tell you something. In Lakewood Yeshiva, they had a soda machine. The most sold soda is what in the yeshiva? No, Mountain Dew. Because it has the most caffeine than all of the other. Yeah, Mountain Dew has more caffeine than Coca-Cola. I never understood it. Why they had Mountain Dew? Who drinks Mountain Dew? I never understood it. What is that? What is drinking Mountain Dew there? No, because it has the most caffeine in it.
That's
it. No, that's it. Anyway. Well, so when it comes to these galuyot, these galuyot over here, as I said, were well documented. And it was also part of a dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. He knew that when he woke up from this dream, this was not a regular dream. This was prophetic. Problem is, you need an interpreter to come and give him an interpretation. So he called on one of his advisors, and his advisor was Daniel. Daniel Ish Hamudot. He worked for Nebuchadnezzar. He told him, what was your dream? He said, I dreamt of a giant. And it says his head was made out of gold, and his arms were made out of silver, and the middle of his body was made out of copper, and his legs and his bottom of his legs were made out of barzel, iron, and at the end of his legs it was made up of hedis. Hedis is potter. So Daniel said, you've dreamt of the four exiles. The head of gold represents you, because you're on top now, you're Bavel. And the Jewish people are going to be under Bavel's power. That's the Rosh. And then the hand is silver. That's Parasumadai. That's the two. It's going to be a double item, Parasumadai. And then after that, the torso and the bottom of the body is going to be Galut Yavan. And then the bottom is going to be Bavel, which is the strongest one. That's the strongest element. That's going to be Galut. Romney, that's going to be the Romans. And in the dream he dreamt that somebody threw a rock, probably an Arab, and they threw a rock at the big giant, and the giant lost its footing and it fell. That indicates that Am Yisrael is going to eventually overcome the Galuyot. So came a rabbi called Sa'adia Gaon. Sa'adia Gaon asked, now what's the significance that on the bottom, which represents the final galut, half of the leg of the regia was made up of iron, and the other half of the leg was made up of hedis. So he was one of the first ones to introduce that at the end of time, the final galut is going to be split between galut Edom and galut Yishmael. Which means, he said, that's indicated in the dream. That once already you see that it's not going to be all, it's not going to all be metal. See, part metal, part pottery, that means the final galut is going to have a second amendment to it. There's going to be 4A and 4B. 4A will be galut Romi, and then at a certain moment it's going to metamorphosize into galut Yishmael. That's why the final exile is a hybrid. It's going to be made up of both. I think it's very significant to talk about this because you don't have to be a prophet to recognize that clearly Yishmael has become very prominent now in this in the world that we're living in. Whereas 30, 40 years ago, Ishmael really wasn't the issue in the world. Ishmael were in the Middle East somewhere, and the real powers were America and Russia and European nations. These were the superpowers, and they're the Bedouins in the Middle East that were always having their scuffles and their fights. It didn't really bother anybody. It wasn't our story, you know. Once in a while, it would flare up, but it wasn't that way. Nobody would say in America that our problem is B'nai Ishmael. 30 years ago, no, less than 30 years ago, before September 11th. You know, if you ask people in America, what's the biggest crisis, they tell you unemployment, the job rate, the interest rates, and all the other things. You told somebody, what about B'nai Ishmael? Ishmael. They didn't know what it is. They couldn't locate it. Today, if you did a survey, not only in America, if you ask the whole world what's one of the overriding issues of the whole world today, it's B'nai Ishmael. How to control and deal with B'nai Ishmael. Anybody that ever goes to an airport, anything that you see in an airport today is only because of B'nai Ishmael. And no other reason. The reason why airport security is making an old lady that's a paraplegic get out of a chair and they turn her upside down because of B'nai Ishmael. And a guy with a turban, they let him right in, the Chavod. because they're too busy checking the paraplegic in the wheelchair. And the other guy walked in, Salam alaikum, oh, Salam alaikum. Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar. The guy, as he's pressing through security, takes out a mat and he's bowing on the mat. And because they're too busy checking the paraplegic. This is what's going on over
some water.
Anyway, that's all because of B'nai Ishmael, whatever you're witnessing today. So it goes without saying that Rav Saadia Gaon's words, which are eventually later echoed by Rav Chaim Vital, we said that at the end of time, there's going to be the fifth exile. The fifth exile is Galut Yishmael. I don't think it's a doubt if we are already in that final phase. For 1940 years, we were in Galut Yava, in Galut Romi. That was without a question. Now, clearly, Galut Yishmael is taking center stage. The Rambam, many years ago, wrote a letter to the Jews of Yemen. The letter would eventually be called Igeret Teman. When he wrote the letter, he didn't write it knowing that it's going to become a pop. He didn't realize that somebody's going to read the mail. He sent a private letter to the Jews of Yemen. But it was such an inspiring letter that eventually they printed it, and it became books on the letter, and it became, a letter for the ages, like the Ramban's letter. All he was doing is writing a letter of Chizuk to B'nai Teman. What was the problem in Yemen in those days? They were being persecuted by B'nai Ishmael. 1,000 years ago, B'nai Ishmael had the empire. And the Yemenites were getting clobbered by them, so the Ramban wants to write him a letter of Chizuk. And he tells them, listen, we've been suffering from this enemy that wants to swallow us, and there's no more greater vicious enemy against us than B'nai Ishmael, and they have no mercy on us, and we've been suffering from their lies and their deceit. Interesting. Even 1,000 years ago, that's the derech, the deceit and the lies and the propaganda. And he writes it in the, you read the Ramban's letter of 1,000 years ago and the ink is still wet. You think it could be written? You think he's writing an editorial in the Wall Street Journal about current events? And then he says, and he writes, and the more we reach out to the B'nai Ishmael to make peace with them, the more they fight against us. Like what he writes, he says, and on this David HaMelech woed when he said, Oyali ki garti besich shachanti maole kedar. Kedar was one of the sons of Ishmael. And David HaMelech, who was a gibor, the gibor usually doesn't show any fear. But when he came to Kedar, he said, Oyali ki garti meshech. Woe to me that I lived for an elongated period of time in the Bedouin tents of Kedar. And then he says, Shlomo HaMelech said, regarding this situation, when he talked about B'nai Ishmael and their inability to live in peace with Am Yisrael, says, Ani shalom v'chi adaber hema lamelchama. That when I reached out and spoke in words of peace, hema lamelchama. They already, and that was only 1,000 years ago. But there's a big difference, Rabbi. There's a big difference because the Rambam wrote 1,000 years ago than what's going on today. Because you tell me, Rabbi, you tell me B'nai Ishmael. It's an old story. You tell them, this is the fifth galut, this is the end of the thing, this is the heres. In those days, there was no alliance between B'nai Ishmael and Rome. There were two separate entities, and on the contrary, they were against each other. It means they were fighting each other. The Crusades, exactly. The Crusaders and the Muslims, the B'nai Ishmael, they were fighting each other. There were wars. Mashiachin today is the concern when you see that the two exiles are coming together. That's the first time you ever seen something. When you see that they start to form alliances between B'nai Romi, which is Europeans, America, and B'nai Ishmael, which can even include Persia, even though Paras is not one of the children of Ishmael, but they represent the religion of Ishmael, that's clear. So when you start to see these two coming together, so that should be very, very concerning. You have a Gemara Yoma. The Gaon de Vilna, he said something amazing. The Gaon de Vilna in the Perush de Sifra de Tzne'uta, he said that when Yaakov Abinu ran away from his father's house, he was forced to run away because Esav was going to kill him. So Esav was worried because he lost the Berachot and he needed to kill Yaakov. So what does he do over here? The pasuk at the end of Parashat Toledot tells us a chidush. The pasuk right is not much the last pasukim over here. Vayelech Esav el Yishmael. Esav went to Yishmael. Vayikach et Mahalat bat Yishmael. And he marries the daughter of Yishmael. The Gaon of Vilna says that Chazak Baruch. Well, how do you know the page I want? Well, the filter screen. You got to open up the mask of the page. Wait a minute, how do you know I have the page I wanted? I read those books. I told him. Amazing. The Gaon says, Esav said from then that he knew he has to make an alliance with Yishmael. He says, this when he went to marry Mahalat, the daughter of Yishmael, this was nothing about love and romance. This was strategic. This marriage over here was not, you know, will you be my wife and all that stuff over there. Again, strictly business, exactly. This over here was to create an alliance between Bnei Yishmael and Esav, and then once he puts them together, boom, I go after Yaakov Abinu. Which means this is a very critical pasuk. We read this pasuk over here. That guy Yishmael, another wife of Esav. Added to the harem. Added to the Rishut and the Isav had another wife, another Marsha'af, you know, Zeresh Ishtoshel Haman, added to the mixture. But this person over here is deadly. This is deadly over here. This is over here, Vayelech Esav and Yishmael. No difference than you're seeing in our generation. When America signs treaties with Bnei Yishmael, this is exactly the pasuk, Vayelech Esav el Yishmael. And Esav goes to Bnei Yishmael and marries them. Marries them means they make a pact. The Gaon de Vilna clearly says, when that happens, everybody should be concerned. When that moment happens, that you see Vayelech Esav el Yishmael, one has to be very, very concerned, because that's already a strategic move that can put Am Yisrael in serious danger. But he says it didn't at that time. Why? Because the pasuk says, Bat Yishmael, he married Bat Yishmael, Ben Avraham, the son of Avraham, Achot Nebayot. She was the sister of Nebayot. So the rabbis are bothered. You're telling me that she's the daughter of Yishmael. Why do you have to tell me that she's the sister of Nebayot? Who's Nebayot? Who cares who Nebayot is? So the Mefarshim explained that by the time Esav got married, Yishmael had died. So she went from being the daughter of Yishmael to the sister of Nebayot, her older brother. So the Gaon says that Yishtabach HaBoreh, because if Yishmael would have been still alive when Esav got married to Bat Yishmael, it would have been over. Wow. The Kiliput would have merged together and it would have been. So Kadosh Baruch Hu b'chazdo got rid of. So when you read this with Achot Nevayot,
comfort.
Holy cow, Baruch Hashem. Achot Nevayot. Because if it wasn't for Achot Nevayot, it's over. See the secrets of the Gaon of Vilna. But you see over here, Rabotai, whenever you see Esav and Yishmael joining together, it has to be concerning. Vayelech Esav El Yishmael, the famous picture of the Mufti of Jerusalem meeting with Adolf Hitler. And they made an alliance together. And the Arabs joined the Nazis. It's no secret. That's well known. And Hitler signed a treaty with the Mufti that when they come into Jerusalem, they'll join the Nazis and kill all the Jews. And the Arabs will have a stake in Yerushalayim, in Har HaBayit. And that's always concerning. Whenever we see Vayelech, Esav, El Yishmael, whenever you see these two getting, these are the two deadly, the deadly pulsions. You understand? The Gaon de Vilna actually also said, this is something that we said the other day, it's worth repetition, that all of the nations of the world, there's 70 nations. I know there's about 150 flags in front of the United Nations. But the Gaon de Vilna classified the nations of the world into 70. You know, today every Zulu tribe that has a minyan somewhere on an island, they give them a flag and they say, come to the United Nations, curse out the Jews. But we don't count every, you know. The Gaon wasn't counting all the little countries on the board of risk. Irkutsk wasn't one of the 70. Madagascar and all those far off places in the bottom of the board over there, and New Zealand, wherever they were, you know, that's not one of the 70. The 70 are, according to Irkutsk. So you see, the 70 are the 70 primary nations. So you have to divide the territories a little differently than it's divided today, but everything is 70. And he says, against the 70 nations is Am Yisrael, which incidentally, we started as a nation as how many? As 70. When we went out to Egypt, which was the name is already that these 70 here are equivalent to the 70 a primary nation. So then Omad Zeh. Although you say, what do you mean? It means each Jew and that generation is connected an entire nation. You understand? So the Gaon said that if you're either from Bnei Esav or Bnei Yishmael, that's the split. Those are the two. Today we would call them either the nations of the West or the nations of the East, of the Middle Eastern nations. Bnei Esav or Bnei Yishmael. So when they asked the Gaon for a proof, he found the proof. The proof he found in Parashat Pinehas. In Parashat Pinehas, it talks about the korbanot that they brought on Sukkot. 7 days of Sukkot, every day they brought tarim. Par is a bull. On the first day of Sukkot, they brought 13 tarim. And the second day, 12 tarim. The third day, 11. And then 10, and then 9, and then 8. All the way down to 7. 13 plus 12 plus 11 plus 10 plus 9 plus 8 plus 7 equals 70. And then with the 70 bulls that they brought on Sukkot, Akenega, the 70 nations. And what about us? We're not included in the 70 nations. That's why God added an extra day called Shemini Aseret. And on Shemini Aseret, how many bulls did they bring? Farehad. So the story of Sukkot is the United Nations.
Wow.
That's why, incidentally, always the United Nations is in session around that time of the year in September and Sukkot time over there. Because all these Korbanot and Me'orer are arousing. When Sukkot comes around, they always have security council meetings and everybody's making derashot and all that over there. Because Sukkot is the meetings in Shamayim are arousing the meetings on earth. In the Shamayim, there's a Torerut. And therefore, the Torerut trickles down that the nations feel them. They got to get up and speak. They got to do something. They got to come to a meeting. They got to come to New York and all that stuff over there. So it's the 70 against the one. The 70 against the one. Shemini Atzeret is our holiday. That's why on Shemini Atzeret, Simchat Torah, we dance with God. It's a very happy day because the other 7 days of Sukkot are more international. But the day of Simchat Torah is domestic. It's all about us and God and nobody else. Pareha, yes? So the Gaon said that Esav, what do you mean? Esav is called Seir. Ba'alu Moshi'im Bar Tzion Mishpot et Har Esav. What is Har Esav? Mount Esav, Mount Esau. What's Mount Esav? Seir Edom. Har Seir. Ba'alu Moshi'im. The Moshi'im will come to Har Seir Mishpot et Har Esav. Right, exactly. The Red Mountain, that's Har Seir. Says Yaakov went to Sukkot and Esav went to Har Seir. So anytime you see the word Seir, you know you're talking about Esav. Whereas Yishmael, he says, is always going to be referred to as Seir Ezim. For different reasons. Ezim is the goat. Because they're Bedouins with the goats, with the animals. Seir Ezim is Yishmael. So he says something incredible. Look at the first day of Sukkot. It says on the first day of Sukkot, how many korbanot did they bring? How many parim? 13. And what does it say at the end of the pasuk? Us'ir izim ehad. Us'ir izim. Who's that? Yishmael. Us'ir izim is reserved in Yishmael. So he says, put 13 on the side of Yishmael. Next day, b'yom ha'sheni, how many parim? Parim b'nei bakar, shenem asab. That's the pasuk. And what is the pasuk? Us'ir izim ehad lehatat. Us'ir izim. Put that on Ishmael's side. So you got 13 plus 12. How many do you have? 25. I got zero. Esav didn't pick up anything yet. Go to day four. I'm skipping day three on purpose, as you noticed. Ubayom arbi'i, which is 10 parim, usir ezim ehad lehatat. 25 plus the 10, 35. By all the other days, what does it say? Usir hatat ehad. Doesn't say seir ezim. Says the Gaon de Vilna, seir ezim has 35, and seir has 35. The Torah was hinting to us 70. That the 70 are going to be split down the middle. They're either going to belong to the European situation, to the American situation, to that alliance, or you're going to be along to the other. That's going to be the either you're part of Seir Ezim or you're part of Seir. That's it. It's a limit in the Pesukim. Why would the Torah sometimes say Seir, sometimes say Seir Ezim? Bidiyuk. Because exactly wanted to tell us this. And then the Mefarshim go on to say, it's amazing. Now, how many watch Shirashini? Now, what do you do? The explanation is like this. I mean, he's everything. So now, the explanation is like this. The Zohar HaKadosh writes that Yishmael has the 35 nations, and they have a leader on top of their nation. Who's the leader? The wife of the Satan, he's controls the 35, and Yishmael or Bnei Edom Esav, the Samechmem himself, the Satan himself is the leader. So you have 35 plus the leader. So the Mefarshim said that this is what David HaMelech was saying. Ele barechem ve'ele basusim ve'anachanu b'shem Adonai Eloheinu nazkir. So the Mefarshim said, if you take the word ele, ele is aleph lamed he. That's the leader plus 35. Ele barechem. Rechem refers to the sophisticated. Rechem is the machinery, the tanks. That represents Esav. Esav has military strength and tanks. Ele, that's referring to Esav. Ele barechem. The ele basusim. Who's that? Bnei Ishmael. They come on their horses. Lawrence of Arabia. They come on their horses, and they come and attack, like you see today.
Rechev is Ishmael.
No, Rechev is Esav. And Susim is Ishmael. So there's Ele, these 35, Rechev. 35 nations with their military tanks. The Ele, the other 35, they're coming what? Ele, but Susim. Va'anachnu. What do we do? The Shem Adonai, the Hirun Eskir. We have to mention just God. And Borei Olam is going to protect us. You see, that's the divide. And you see, the world today is basically falling into this divide. Either you're with Bnei Ishmael or you're with Bnei Esav. This is, you see, it's coming. But the more concerning thing is, you see today is that when Bnei Edom and Bnei Esav are coming together, anytime you see Vayelech Esav and Yishmael, watch out. And that's what we're seeing today. The Gemara in Yoma on page 10. You see, I don't have to read the newspaper because I study Gemara. So I know the news before it happens. See, by the time you get the news and you're by your doorstep, I knew that news already when I was 4 years old, what you're reading in the newspaper today, because I learned Gemara. Wow. So when you tell me, I read in the New York Post, it says this, I say, hold on, New York Post, nothing in the Gemara in the New York Post. Here's the New York Post. Take another magazine, another newspaper over there. I say, oh, that's the Gemara in Sotah, page 14. You read it, oh my God, how'd you get this over here? Which means, this is over here, a newspaper that tells you the future, what's going to happen. I'm not interested in a newspaper that tells me what happened already. Old news. Old news, not interested. You burn it. You throw it into the fire. You burn it with your hametz. But this is the futuristic newspaper. That's why the people that come to Gemara in the morning, they're reading tomorrow before it happens. The Gemara over here is in your Madaf Yud. It tells you the news before it happens. Here the Gemara says that Amazon is going to go up 80 points. If you would have read this Gemara, you could have been a millionaire yesterday. But you don't read the Gemara. Oh, it happened? I see that. I know. That's what it says. The Gemara says. Bitterus Gemara.
Wow.
In the wrong business. You got to be reading the Gemara. You guys would have known inside trading. Okay. Every single thing, what to buy, how to buy it. Instead, you get after it. On that same Gemara, in Gemara Yoma Daf Yud, the Gemara says something amazing. Gemara says, Amar Rava Bar Hanna, Amar Rabbi Yohanan Mishum Rabbi Yehuda Rabbi Elai. Atida Romi Shetibol Biyad Paras. Oho. Atida Romi Shetibol Biyad Paras. That Rome, which is Bnei Esav, eventually will be subjugated and fall to Paras. Paras is what?
Iran.
Paras is Iran. Persia is Iran. Now, if you read this Gemara 30 years ago, you said, Iran, what's Iran? Iran was nothing, there's nothing going on over there. Iran was stuck with a war with Iraq for many years, a war of attrition. They were just killing each other. Ken Yavdu Kol Oyvei Hashem. When they asked me, what do you think about the war between Iraq and Iran? I said, I hope both sides win. Wish them both luck. I wish them both luck. But the point is, who would believe Rome is going to be subjugated to Paras? It's Paras. It's Paras. Why would it be subjugated to Paras? So when all of a sudden Paras took 400 U.S. hostages and America was stuck, Jimmy Carter didn't know what to do. Jimmy Carter was making all berachot on the peanut butter, trying to make some good law to try to... Didn't work. 1974. Nothing. He couldn't get one hostage out. So then everybody opened his Gemara. Oh, you see, Atidah Romi, that's going to be under Paras. And Paras is able to... But that was only the beginning of this process. Here you see now that Paras comes along and Romi in very, very weak position, in a very, as if Romi is very, very weak, as if they have to negotiate to give them $150 billion and to allow them to, and as they're giving them the money, Paras is saying, Yemach Shemchem, death to you, death to your country. And the more they say it, the more America says, take more, have another thing, and we're going to kill your allies, and we're going to kill you, and even after we sign it, we still hate you, and nothing changes. And they're coming along and saying, take more. And if anybody has half a brain, you can't understand, how could you give all this money? They say, no, but we're delaying a nuclear reactor for 10 years. Even if you would delay it, but with $150 billion, you can wreak havoc throughout the whole world with all that money. Why was Romi, which had such a strong position, keep on the sanctions, keep on the sanctions. You're killing them. On the contrary, in a negotiation, you just keep on tightening it until they come along and say, we surrender. Instead, they went into negotiations telling them, basically, you have to do nothing. Just let a couple of meskihim from the kollel come check the nuclear reactors. Like the meskihim do over here. They come in and they say, kosher, give me a sandwich, please. Ask the guy, give me a sandwich, please. They taste kosher. That's what you have. A couple of the black cats going to check out the nuclear reactors and that over there. And that's all it is. What are they checking? And for that, you get $150 billion. So the Gemara said, what do you think? It's a prophecy. Atidah Romi Shittipol B'yad Paras. What does it mean, B'yad Paras? B'yad Paras means B'yad Paras. That's B'yad in the contract. You're going to sign B'yad Paras. Not necessarily a war, but B'yad Paras. The negotiators are going to sign documents. They're going to sign papers. B'yad Paras. And strategic alliance is going to be made. Atidah Romi Shittipol. Well, this is already they fell. Already when you sign such a thing, already you've committed yourself to a... But this is, again, you've seen it in our time. Vayelech Esav Etzel Yishmael. You've seen it now in our time. Again, even though Paras is not B'nai Yishmael, but the religion that they serve is B'nai Yishmael. That's clear. The Sunnis or the Shia, whatever they are.
Sunnis and Shiites.
That's the B'nai Ishmael. The Nasi himself is a hybrid of both, which we never had in our country. We always had, Anglo-Saxon. We always had, Christian. Now you have a combination. Part Ishmael, part Esav. So therefore, when you have the hybrid in the Rosh, so already he's the one that's going to... This is what we're doing over here, Rabotai. Now, I didn't finish scaring you. I have to, some more scary things to tell you in order to... that you should have bad dreams tonight. Chas v'shalom, a couple of scares. But I'm just trying to tell you, so
we knew about this from the reading Gemara. So they could write about the newspaper. They signed the deal. What are you telling me? Yad Parah. Now, the Zohar Kadosh says that there are many examples that the Torah uses to refer to Bnei Ishmael and Bnei Esav. The Gaon de Vilna again writes that the Shoresh, that the root of Bnei Esav comes from Kayin. Kayin. Don't ask. Kayin was a Bechor, Esav is a Bechor, Kayin killed, Esav killed, Kayin went after the extra girl that Heber was born with. Esav, it says, used to take girls and take them from their husbands. Sad Nashim, Tahad Yedeh Ba'alehem. So the shortage of Esav's nature is found in Kayin. And the shortage of Yishmael, he says, is in Heber. Now, I can explain it simply because Kayin in the holy books is Midat Hadin, and Hevel represents Midat Hesed. Esav is the son of who? Yitzhak. Yitzhak is what? Midat Hadin. Yivura. So therefore, Esav is the Kilipa of Din. He comes from that. And Ishmael is the son of Abraham. Abraham is what? Hesed. So Ishmael is the Kilipa of Hesed. That's why when you go to Bnei Ishmael, they're very hospitable. Fadda, drink coffee, have scotch before they kill you, but drink something, eat something. Huh? So the Kayin is Midat Adin, and Hebel is Midat Hesed. So therefore the Gaon says that Kayin is the shortage of Esav, and Hebel is the shortage of Ishmael. We give it emes to this. In Alinu Leshabeya, we say Shehem Mishtahavim Lehebel Barik. So the rabbis are questioning, says, this is Yoshua Ben Nun tells us, right, Lord? When Yeshua wrote this, there was only one major religion in the world, Judaism. Everybody else was, into all that other type of stuff. But later on, there'd be three major religions in the world. One, of course, is Judaism, which is the Emet. And then the two spin-offs. One would be Christianity, and one would be Islam.
What about the Buddhists?
Huh? What about the Buddhists? I'm going to get to them in a minute. Well, you're representing the Buddhists, I'm going to talk about the Buddhists. Equal time, I'll talk about the Buddhists. What about the Buddhists? Now watch over here. Those are the main. So David, the Yoshua Ben Nun said, Shem Ishtarim Nehebel Varik. If you take the word Varik, Varik is Vav is 6 and Resh is 200 and Yud is 10. So that's 216 and Kof is 100. Varik equals 316. Gematria Yeshu. Yud, Shin, Vav. Bnei Esav. Shem Ishtarim Nehebel Varik. That's why in the old shoes by the Ashkenazim, the custom was when they say the Hebel Varik, they spit on the floor. Yeah. The Hebel Varik, they know it's referring to Yeshu. The Arabs themselves, they have three holidays in the year. They have the big holiday that they call the Eid al-Kabir. And then they have the small holiday that they call Eid al-Zghir. The big holiday is 5 days. The small holiday is 2 days. And then they have the Ramadan, which is 30 days. That's heaven. The He is 5, which is Eid al-Kabir. And the Bet is Eid al-Zghir. And the Lamed is the 30 days. Shem Mishtahavim Laheben Varik. Yeshua already was hinting to the two different religions that are going to be manifest in those times. Understand? Lahebel Varik. V'anachnu mishtahavim lefnei melech malchei ha'malechim ha'kadosh baruch hu. That's why later on in the book of Devarim, I have to go already, Rabotai. And later on in the book of Devarim, it says that the people at the end of time are going to worship Etzba Eben. Everybody says Etzba Eben. Who in the right mind is going to worship Etzba Eben? The Christians, what do they worship? The cross. That's it. And what do the Arabs worship? The stone, the rock. The rock. Etzba Eben. Everybody is hinting to us the two major religions. Anyway, so the Gaon of Vilna said that Esav is from Chayim and Hebel is from, in Yishmael is Hebel. I'll give you the remnants of Hebel. With this he explained something incredible. And he said, what's the secret and the source of why you have to check your suits for sharpness? Why do you have to check your suits for sharpness? Wool is permissible by itself. Linen is permissible by itself. And all of a sudden you make a blend, and all of a sudden it becomes your suit d'oraita. The Gemara, the Zohar says your tefillot cannot be accepted. If you're wearing sharpness, your tefillot are not accepted. A guy once came to me and said, Rabbi, I have the best kippur of my life. He showed me his mahzor drenched in tears. I opened the suit. I said, where's the sharpness ticket? I didn't check, I didn't tell him anything. I walked away, I said, miskin. The collar of that suit, all sharpness. That was hilarious, exactly. And therefore what? All the tefillot scrambled. There's no reception on that. All the tears and all that over there, haval. If you would have taken off the sport jacket, he would have been better. That's why when you pray on Kippur on any day, before you check your sidur, you have to check your suits for sharpness. Otherwise, the tefillot are not accepted. What's the big avon, said the Gaon on the Vilna of sharpness? What's the big avon? He said, because what did Kayin bring as a korban on that day? He brought flax, he brought pishtan. Rashi says, pishtan. And what did Hevel bring? Hevel brought tzemer. He brought wool. So he says, when one takes wool and linen, what you're doing is you're putting Kayin and Hevel together, which means you're putting Esav and Yishmael together.
Wow.
Which means the guy doesn't realize. The guy goes, it's a big deal. You don't realize that you're changing the whole world, that Yishmael and Esav, they come together through our actions. So that when we separate wool and linen, when the rabbi in the laboratory is pulling out the wool and the linen, that's affecting the world. We're pulling out those threads, B'nai Yishmael, B'nai Esav are moving away from each other. But when a guy comes along and they tell you, want to check your suit for sharpness? Nah, I don't do that. He's butchering it. He's going to kill the suit. I paid $3,000 for the suit. I'm not interested in all that. Chas v'shalom. It's not only wearing a sharpness suit. The damage that it does politically in the world. So therefore, that's just the rem is that every mitzvah that you do has a repercussion on world events. Because you can think. So when a guy's checking his suit for sharpness, and you're standing online, it's worth it. It's worth it to stand online and all that, get a ticket when you come out of there. Why? Because you're telling me to stand online for 15 minutes to separate B'nai Ishmael and B'nai Isab? Well, it's a great thing, I'll do it. I'm going to ask about it to have the sharpness so I can separate them. I'm going to be careful to buy sharpness only so I can separate them. You understand what I'm saying? That's what they go on the illness says. That's what go on the illness says. So you see clearly that we're in very, very special times. We're in very special times. Now already the pottery of the bottom of the foot is already starting to show itself. But I will conclude, although there's much more to say about that, but I will conclude. Tisha B'Av shechal liyot b'Shabbat. This is this year. Tisha B'Av shechal liyot b'Shabbat. So as important as the fast of Tisha B'Av is, it's deferred. Pushed off until Sunday. although Kippur, we don't defer, and there were some opinions that even Asara B'Tevet, if it fell out on a Shabbat, some held, we would say the certain fasts are mohashu. But for that, for some reason, Shabbat Av, Shaliyot B'Shabbat, we waive it. You could have a Saudah like Shalom Melech. You don't have to do anything. Right? Tomorrow is no basic. Regular Shabbat. Shabbat Hazon. What's the explanation? If it's such a serious Amon and very such a serious day, they should have kept it on Shabbat. They should have made it. You have to fast on Shabbat. Listen, pregnant ladies have to fast, nursing women have to. Which is normally leniencies that we have for every other fair, Shabbat, nothing. New clothes, freshly laundered, everything kicks in. But for some reason, when it came to Shabbat, Achamim said, Adkam, we're not touching the Shabbat. We're not going to ruin the Shabbat, leave the Shabbat, we'll push it off to Sunday. Simple interpretation. You want the simple interpretation first? Okay. Because she asked for it. The simple interpretation is, because Rabbi Yohanan said in the Gemara that if I was around at the time of the institution of Tisha B'Av, I would have made it on the 10th. Because the 10th day, the majority of the Beit HaMikdash got burned. So therefore, on a regular fast, okay, we defer it, we don't defer, but our job, there's a reason to push it to the 10th. Because some say that should have been the real day. Anyway, so the deferring of Tisha B'Av makes sense. Because really, the rabbis held you should make it on the 10th. Even when we fast on the 9th, the 10th day still has stuff. You can't eat meat, you can't do this. There's still rules on the 10th. You understand? But they didn't want to touch the Shabbat. They didn't want to touch it for another reason. For reasons that we've explained to you already. When we talk about B'nai Yishmael and B'nai Esav, we're talking about the religions that they represent. Hebel Barik, Etzra Eben. It's the religions that they represent. The religion of Ishmael is celebrated on which day?
Friday.
On Friday. There used to be a place, I'm not going to say what. They used to have a big sign, Closed Fridays. Okay, Closed Fridays. Why Closing Fridays? Remember the place? Why are you Closing Fridays? They were open on Shabbat, but they closed Fridays. They put a big sign, Closed Fridays. Lion meat, Closed Fridays. So you see over here, Fridays is the day of B'nai Yishmael. And what is the day of B'nai Esav?
Sunday.
So Shabbat is right in the middle. So the Kiddushah, the Shabbat, is able to destroy both sides of what's to the right of it and what's to the left of it. The Benu Ari said in the song that we sing tonight, Yemina Usmana Ubena Rukana. He said, Yemina to the right, you have Bnei Ishmael. Because Bnei Ishmael are on the right, they're Chesed, they're the children of Abraham. So Yemina, that's why they picked the right. That's why they're on Friday. Usmana is Bnei Esav, they're Kedipav Din. That's why they picked the left of Sunday. That's why they're on the left of Shabbat, that's why they're on Sunday. Yemina Usmana, who's in the middle? Ubenayhu Kala. And the Shabbat, Malketa, Shabbat Kala, Bo'i Kala is right in the middle. And the Shemirah of the Shabbat is able to destroy it. And therefore the Hachamim said, on Tisha B'Av, Shahaliyot B'Shabbat, just keep the Shabbat, don't fast, don't get, keep the Shabbat. That's the greatest bunker buster on both sides of the day before and the day after. Therefore, Adrabah, you shouldn't think that we're deferring the fast. We're fasting in a different way. We're fulfilling the day in a different way.
by keeping this Shabbat specifically, Shabbat Adja, the rabbi said by letting them eat and have the Seudot and make the Tefillot and go to a regular Shabbat, and we've told you many times that that's where they got the inyan of accepting Shabbat a little early. Because by accepting Shabbat a little early, you're bringing the Kiddushah of Shabbat into Friday. Boom, you destroyed Friday. And you're supposed to delay the Shabbat a little, so you bring the Kiddushah of the Shabbat into Sunday. So now the Kiddushah of Shabbat spreads. It goes to the right and to the left. And therefore, the Shemirah of all the Shabbatot clearly are important. But the Shabbat of Shabbat, the Shabbat, this Shabbat specifically, after all this introduction of the Galuyot and of the connections that were involved in the Hatashanot. If a person, I'm done, Elliot, I have one more, I have to go. I have to go. I have to go to the bathroom, to be honest with you. What else do you want to know? To answer to my wife, I have to answer to this guy. So now, the explanation is like this, which means the Shabbat separates between Friday and Sunday. But Rabotai, if there's no Shabbat, what ends up happening? The Friday and the Sunday are connected. Which means you need to put the buffer. Without that buffer of keeping the Friday separate and the Sunday separate, you need the Shabbat in between. And therefore, Chas v'Shalom Chilul Shabbat, it creates a blank zone over here. And now there's nothing interrupting between the Kiddush. There's no Kiddushah here. And therefore, the Friday and the Sunday are linked. And Chas v'Shalom, it causes this dangerous. So therefore, there's no greater protection. That's why it said, V'shamru b'nei Sata Shabbat. And the Ibn Ezra said, Ki eshmera Shabbat, el yishmerein. That's a midah connected midah. You shomer Shabbat. So Shabbat says, you're watching me, I'm going to watch you. There was one great rabbi. He wouldn't sleep on Shabbat. When they told him, Hakam, you know, 24 hours he would stay up. He said, I'm a shomer Shabbat. Can a shomer sleep? I'm the God. If a God sleeps, who's going to be shomer the Shabbat? And therefore I have to be up the whole time making sure that I'm shomer the Shabbat. He understood that the Shabbat needs not only a Shemirah, meaning passive, to be Shomer the Shabbat properly. And then we get all the sigulot of all the protections. And therefore, specifically on Shabbat, Shaliyot, the Shabbat, that's when we need to keep this, we need to set a pick between Friday and Sunday. And then Be'ezrat Hashem will be fulfilled, the pasuk that we read on Shabbat. ועלו מושיעים בהר ציון לשפוט את הרשע וידע לאדוני המלוכה אמן ואמן.